All right, we are here with the great Parvati Shallow. Parvati, how are you?
I'm doing great. How are you?
It is so exciting to be here. So great to see you. And I can't believe you're going to do this again.
I know. I've already done it.
Yes.
So it's done. But also now we have to relive the trauma. So that's okay. That's great.
Where is John Fincher?
John Fincher, our nanny, yes, left us for a new family last week.
What?
I know. I was like, what are you trying to say?
Yeah.
She has a full-time job now, and we were only using her part-time, so we don't have a babysitter. So he's on daddy duty tonight.
Okay. Well, hope to see
We'll be at your party.
Okay. All right.
Very
excited about that. Parvati, how do you get ready to go back and play again? You have such a big target, I would imagine, because of your legacy. So what did you do to get ready to go do this again?
Okay. Well, you know how the game goes because you're an expert and you've studied it for years and years and also played. So you know there are a few things that you have to do to prepare.
Yeah.
And one of those things is physically, you got to get your body right. Mm-hmm. And I was busy being pregnant and having a baby. So I hadn't worked out in like 2 years when they called me to go back and play. And I was like, I guess I should start working out. So I had to stop breastfeeding, first of all. And I had to start working out. So I started doing that. I was doing like box jumps. I was doing stair climbs. But, you know, the most important thing is where your head is at going back out there and playing the game.
Was there any hesitation on your part to go back? I never felt like you were dying to go do Survivor again. Did it take a lot of convincing for you to go back?
Yep, you are 100% right. I was never dying to go back and play. But what happened was I got a call, and the person who called me is a heavy hitter. I mean, you might know him, Jeff Probst. And he said, we're going to need you to come back and play. Like, this is important. It's an epic season. And I was like, oh, my God, they're doing winners. And my FOMO at that point just started to bubble up from deep within. And I was like, I have to prepare myself and I have to go out there ready to compete and win with the best of the best.
Do you talk to your husband, a Survivor player, and get any advice? Or you feel like that he doesn't know as much as you do about how to play the game?
John really wanted to give me a lot of advice. He was trying very hard to get his point across. You know, but I will say, what John is very good at is like spatial awareness and puzzles. And he's so good at packing the trunk of the car for ski trips. So I was like, why don't you help me with puzzles? Because that's not my skill set. It's not my forte. So he did. He was able to help there. Strategy? No. Not looking to John Fincher for strategy.
And what's the most exciting part for you about being a part of this all-winter season?
Oh, man, I think that this has just been like an idea in the making for so long, and that Jeff had let it go. He'd resigned himself to the fact that this was never going to happen. And I think a lot of people really thought this would never happen. And then for some reason, the stars aligned. And as fate would have it, a lot of people said yes. And now we have this really cool, extremely exciting, epic season. Also, it came at a time in my life where I was like really incapable of doing much, but like taking care of a small being. So I think just the fact that I was able to put myself back in this arena at this time is pretty spectacular to me, like personally.
And what does it mean to you to have so many of your fans excited to have you come back for this season?
The most exciting thing is the fans right now. I am living for my fans on Instagram right now. When I played before, we didn't have Instagram. Yeah. It was like maybe Twitter was coming online and a little bit of Facebook, but I never used that. I love Instagram, and I love everyone that's using your app on Instagram, putting their like Survivor winner over their head. It's so cute. So I hope it keeps happening because it's the best.
Parvati, we're so excited to see you back on the season, and it's so great to see you here tonight. And how's the baby? Good?
She's doing amazing. She's like climbing up walls and scaling rocks, and she's ready to win Survivor.
Okay. All right. Well, maybe one day. What is that? Survivor 80, all the kids?
Ama versus Dominic.
Okay. All right.
Mano a mano. Who's going to win?
All right, Parvati, good luck in the season. I know you already filmed it. We can't wait to see how it plays out.
Thanks, Rob.
We are here with the winner of Survivor Ghost Island, Wendell Holland. Wendell, how are you?
I'm doing well, sir. How are you?
Very excited for the Winners at War. Very excited to see you out here. And we can't wait to see how this is going to play out. Was there any hesitation for you to come back for season 40?
No hesitation. As soon as they called, I was ready to go. I was ready to go at the end of Ghost Island. So,
what did you do to prepare to get ready to play in season 40?
Well, according to the press photos, I clearly ate a lot, even though I didn't think I ate a lot. But what did I do? I just rewatched a bunch of seasons, talked to my buddy Dom a little bit, and just tried to hone my strategy, you know?
Can I ask you, what did Dominic tell you before you went out there to go do?
Dom told me to chill out a little bit, not build as many things, and take it easy and try not to be the super visible person, because I just played, you know, two seasons prior.
When you're getting ready to go out there, are there people that give you advice that you don't want? Like, are there a lot of people in your ear that are telling you stuff and it's like, you know, honestly, I don't want any more advice?
I signed an NDA, so I didn't tell anybody that I was going out for season 40. Now, you get advice from people. I stuck to my guy, Dom. I stuck to myself. And your baby boy, Bryce, he would come over and help train with me. He'd be there like 6 in the morning. We'd be swimming in the pool. Or he had me running in the pool because there's a lot of running in the water challenges. So that was my preparation. I didn't listen to any strategy that Bryce gave me because you and I know he didn't do so well.
He's got a good social game.
That he does. I mean, how'd it do him on Kagaya?
Oh, come on. Yeah, that was a raw deal. That was a bad deal. Who were you starstruck to meet, if anybody?
Oh, I was pretty starstruck to meet Boston Rob.
Yeah.
That guy, I didn't know how I would take to him, meeting him. But yeah, I was a little starstruck to meet him. I'd say Ethan as well, Parv. These are players that, you know, I've tried to be pretty social and, you know, get out in the Survivor community and meet everyone. These are players that I haven't met, but they're on the Rushmore. And yeah.
Do these old school players, is there any sort of like hazing, and like that you're a new guy, you just won, that do they gang up on you at something like this?
They always made me get water. They took their towels and they would slap me in the butt with them. They would walk all over me. They'd treat me as a towel. No, they wouldn't do it. They didn't do anything. They knew that. I think they knew that because their targets as these, like, you know, the Rushmore coming back, they had big targets. Yeah. So
I'm just talking about tonight.
Oh, tonight.
Yeah.
Tonight. Oh, I'm last at everything. I was last in line over there. I was last to do interviews. Yeah, I'm just last at everything. But that's okay. I'll take it.
What have you been up to outside of Survivor?
Outside of Survivor, working, building still. Yeah. You know, Beav Unlimited is my furniture company. Yeah. As a matter of fact, in 2 weeks, I'm going down to the Ron Clark Academy to install some giant barnwood doors.
Yeah.
They have like a kind of like a medieval-y theme in one of the buildings, and they want some doors that are 5 feet wide by 10 feet tall. Yeah. So I got some work ahead of me.
Yeah, we're getting ready to go to the Ron Clark Academy for the podcast, and I'm learning that Ron doesn't do anything small.
He does nothing small. I think he might have sent me a flyer or something with some faces on it. Yeah, that's going to be quite the event.
Yeah, yeah, he's working on some stuff. Wendell, how excited have you been to see the response from your fans about your participation in this season?
It's been overwhelming for me. I didn't know it was like this because I'm the fan playing right now, you know, and I'm just geeking to play with these guys. And then I got fans that are like, yeah, Wendell, you're going to win. And, you know, all these things that they're saying to me. So it's awesome. And I'm having this watch party and our tickets like sold out already. And it's crazy to see the overwhelming support from Philadelphia, but also like all across America.
Yeah. Wendell, so great to see you at this. Can't wait to see the show tonight, and good luck this season.
Thank you very much, Rob.
All right, I'm so excited. We are here with Rob and Amber Mariano. How are you guys doing?
Yeah, we're doing great. What's going on, bud?
This is so great, Rob. That I feel like that everybody's like, all right, we've seen Boston Rob. We're excited to see Amber.
Well, thanks. That's quite the compliment.
Yeah, I'm excited to see her too. I hope she does good.
Amber, Jeff Probst said that you were the biggest get out of all of the winners on this season. How does that make you feel?
I think it's the ultimate compliment. I mean, I'm out here with all the greats, and it's just the fact that I was the get he's just, I'm very thankful of that. It's hard to believe because I think all these people out here are pretty great gets.
So when I saw the cast list, I really was very surprised to see both of you out there, because I know, I've heard Rob say, hey, you know, maybe just Amber will go play. And I thought that maybe Amber will play and you stay home. I was very surprised to see both of you go out there. Was there any talk about maybe Amber just go and you were going to stay back?
Season 40, bro. It's like the most epic season in the history of the show. When Jeff called, he's like, you want to do it? And I was like, I don't know, maybe. He's like, could you get Amber to do it? And I was like, we're in. We're doing it. We can't not be a part of it. Survivor is like, you know, given us so much in our life, and we're so thankful that, like, in such a celebratory season, we just felt like, you know, honored and happy to be asked.
So I'm so curious, when you guys are getting ready to go, do the two of you like get together and it's like, all right, here's the game plan, or do you feel like, hey, I feel differently about certain people, or are you guys mostly like, we're on the same page coming in on how you felt about people?
Justinino, we can't give you all the secrets, buddy. What about season 50 and 60? No. We talked about it, and we practiced making fire and, you know, making sure that we knew how to do everything.
Yeah, I mean, but the thing is that you never know what Jeff's going to throw out there. You can't be prepared for anything, and the best players are able to adapt to all the changes and all the new stuff coming along. So we tried to prepare the best we could.
My wife and I are so jealous that you two got to go, and then it's like a vacation to get to go away from the kids and be away, and it's not like, hey, you left me alone to watch the kids. What a treat it must have been for you two.
It really was, to be able to go back to where it all began. What just brought back so many great memories, and yeah, we miss the girls, and it's hard not speaking to them for that long, but the fact to go back to where we met and fell in love, it was awesome.
Yeah.
Do you guys tell the kids that what you're going to go do, or do they think you're like going on like a vacation to go and be gone?
We told them what we were doing this time. We felt like they're old enough. It was like 1 week before school got out, you know, it was almost a year ago. So we figured, like, if they can keep the secret for a week, we're good. And if not, they're probably not going to tell the other kids. By the time school starts again, they'll probably forget whatever they told them. So it was nice. We told them the truth, what we're doing. They were excited for us.
I think it made it easier on them knowing what we were doing, because then they understood why we weren't calling home and why we were leaving them for so long. It's hard to come up with a story of why mommy and daddy are both leaving and not being able to call them for that long. That's hard to come up with something like that. So it was good to be able to tell them the truth.
I don't want to interrupt the interview, but can you get a shot of Ethan's suit, like the jacket and the pants? This is straight out of the J. Crew 1995 catalog. 95. It's vintage. Okay, so just in case anybody wants to know what he's wearing here, 1995 J. Crew Fall Edition.
Why is Ethan like trying to box you out?
He obviously has a complex. You know, being on Survivor, it's been a while for him.
He's not even on camera.
The last time he was on Survivor was back in Survivor Africa, and he's trying to pay attention to your own interview, bro. Come on, so rude. Some things never change, Rob, you know?
What's next for you guys? Back a third time in the Amazing Race?
I mean, that's pretty much the way the schedule's going now. We're gonna give it a break for a while and just, you know, go home and relax. For the summer.
For the summer.
Nah, dude, I'm done, man.
No, this is what we're going to do. We're going to go home and watch a season with the girls. We've been looking forward to this for almost a year now. They're so pumped. They're so excited to watch their mommy and daddy back on Survivor again. It's going to be awesome.
What you say?
Well, we're so excited to see how this is going to play out. I'm really excited to see you guys both out there for this season. And I hope it's going to be a great one.
Good deal, man. Thanks. Say hi to your wife and kids.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good seeing you.
We are here in person with the queen, the two-time so far winner of Survivor, Sandra Diaz-Twine. Sandra, how are you?
I'm wonderful. Excited and nervous for tonight's episode.
Yes. Okay. Well, Sandra, it is such a treat to see you back out here. You were on the Island of the Idols. You talked about that you and Rob had not talked about season 40 in that little clip that we got to see. Did you know you were going to play in season 40 when you went out there for season 39?
No, towards the end of season 39, I want to say like 10 days before we left, Jeff just mentioned, Sandra, Rob, would you guys be interested in possibly coming back out? But it wasn't set in stone. He just mentioned it.
Yeah.
I said yes right away. Rob said no right away. That was that. We went our separate ways when we both got to L.A. and never spoke. And next thing you know, we're on the island. He's there. Not only is he there, he's with Amber.
Yeah.
What did you do to get ready for season 40 to come back for All Winners?
Well, I only had a two-week break between 39 and 40 because me and Rob were out there for 36 whole days. So I just tried to stay on the same kind of diet because we were on a wonderful island and we were able to eat. You know, we had almond trees and a lot of coconut trees and we had a lot of papaya, a lot of sugarcane. Like, we had everything, wild chickens and roosters. We even had goats, but I couldn't eat those. And I was lucky because, like, the chickens laid eggs, but he don't eat eggs. So I was eating that, and he'd go get fish, and I'd eat fish. So we were on this island, and we were eating, you know, but we were eating healthy. And so when I went home, I was like, I'm not going to pig out because I'm going to go back there to starve again. So I wanted to keep this same, you know, I didn't want to mess up my body filling it up with bullshit, so.
Yeah.
Sandra, I feel like that you're the authority on all of the winners of Survivor. Who should have also been out here?
Tina should have been out here. Tom Westman should have been out here. Todd should have been out here. Earl should have been out here. Definitely Mike Holloway.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah. They could have had more people.
Yeah. We could have had like 25 winners.
Yeah.
So who out of the winners that weren't coming, did anybody try to give you advice on how to play when you were going to go back?
No, because I wouldn't. Why would I ask somebody else for advice? Yeah. I mean, come on.
I didn't say you asked for it, but sometimes, you know, they try to give it to you.
No. No, nobody. Nah.
Yeah.
What's your favorite part about getting to play Survivor?
My favorite part about playing Survivor is attempting to get to the end, and when I do, actually winning the money. That's it.
So it's just winning. That's
winning. Like adventure. If I want an adventure, I'll pay for it. I come to Survivor to get my money.
Yeah.
What have you been up to outside of Survivor?
We just moved from McDill Air Force Base to Tampa. I actually helped my husband drive on Friday all the way to, not Tampa, to Texas. It took us 2 days to get over there, and then I flew back home Tuesday night because my dog was really, really sick, and then he passed away the next morning.
Yeah, I'm very sorry that I had seen that. I'm very sorry to hear that.
Came here, so it's only been a couple of days. Like, and so once I'm done here with the premiere, I'll go back home and I'll jump in my car with my last dog and drive to Texas.
Any luck on trying to get your statue back to your house?
No, there's no way the statue can come back to my house because the statue of me and Rob actually came on 5 barges. So who's going to pay to get the barge to come? You know, like, I don't live by the water, so no. I want to think it's no longer there anymore. I don't know. I mean, it didn't help that while we were interviewing, you could see our, you know, totems out there during the interview process before the game started.
Yeah. Yeah. That's not ideal. Yeah.
Not ideal because these winners are like, you know, and here we are saying that, you know you've made it when you got a totem, and the only two that got a totem is me and Rob. And
right.
Surrounded by 18 people that are haters.
So tell me, did you enjoy getting to go back for season 39 and be a mentor to the new survivors on the Island of the Idols?
I really did enjoy the 36 days that we were on Island of the Idols. It was a privilege for me to serve as a mentor because I never thought I'd be one of the greats in Survivor history. You know, when I set out to play back in 2003, I never thought that this would be my life 17 years later. You know, that I've been involved in 5 survivors. So being a mentor, I was like, oh my God, what do I talk to these kids about? And Jeff was like, just be you. So, you know, Rob would do the lesson, but then I'd sit them down and say, you know, tell me about your survivor journey. You know, how did you get here? And tell me about camp life and how you're doing back there and your alliances and what's going on with you. And then they just start talking because I'm a talker. They just start talking.
Sandra, well, I'm so excited to have you a part of this season. It's so great to see you here tonight. And we can't wait to see everything that's going to happen.
week. Thank you so much. I really appreciate it.
Sandra, I love getting to talk to you.
You know I love you.
Yeah.
Even when I'm mad at you.
No. We are here with the winner of Survivor Africa. Here he is. Easy. Ethan Zahn is here. Ethan, how are you?
Oh, my God. I'm incredible. This is a truly beautiful moment. We were there when it all started back in the day.
Yes. You are Mr. Old School. You've, like, adopted that. Do you have old school T-shirts?
I have old school T-shirts, old school underwear, hats, whatever you need. I got it.
Yeah. I'm so excited to see you back out here for participating in this season. I never thought that you would go play Survivor again. Was that was always something that you wanted to do as you were recovering from the Hodgkin's lymphoma?
So, I mean, did you think I'd never play because you thought I was dead?
I didn't know. Of course not. But I thought that, you know, Survivor takes a serious toll on your body. I just thought that it was something that, again, and I'm not a smart person. I'm like, hey, I would not want to be in a weakened state after going through something like that.
You know, yes. So to answer your question, it wasn't an immediate, like, I'll do it. And I had to get some serious medical clearance. And, like, I was on my couch, like, eating Doritos, smoking weed, and I got the call. Because, like, you always know it's hovering out there, but I didn't think that, I mean, but then when I got the call, it's like, yeah, let's do this. And I did everything in my power to get ready for this thing, but it was not easy. Like, cancer, I feel like when a doctor tells you to do something, you die, you do it, right? There's no choice. But after cancer, like, getting yourself back to a situation where I'm mentally and physically and, like, spiritually in a place where you can take on the show Survivor and everything that it brings to you, it was just getting to day one was a win for me. Let's just put it that way.
Yeah. Well, so many people are excited to see you back out there to participate in this season. What did you do to prepare for it?
I did a lot to prepare, to be honest. So, like I said, I was living in New Hampshire. It was cold. I moved to a warmer climate. I had to get myself in shape again. I was doing puzzles and knots, lip reading, body language, lighting fires again. I went old school, trying to do all the tips and tricks that I learned early on, you know, to try to prepare myself for this season. You know, I watched all the episodes again. I listened to your podcast.
Oh, you did. Is it helpful? Oh, don't say that. But
the Encyclopedia Britannica of the Survivor world.
Yeah. Put it this way: once you go through the torture of listening to a bunch of the podcasts, then you're ready to handle whatever Survivor can throw at you.
I would pay for an upsell if you edited all your season episodes down to like 3 minutes.
3 minutes,
And they were about me. I would pay for that.
Yeah. Yes, Jeff.
I'm not going home, man.
Yeah. Again. What does he mean again? Anyway, Ethan, this is so exciting.
As a player and fan, when you heard about season 40, what did that mean to you?
Oh, it was super exciting. Again, I was very surprised to see you as being one of the people that was gonna be on it. But
for health reasons, or just because you thought I was over it?
Well, I thought it was for health reasons, but I also kind of felt like that you were not dying to go and play Survivor, and no pun intended. But I just thought that you were a person who was not, because I talked to the new players. The new players are all, you know, clamoring to go back, and I just wasn't really getting that from you.
Yeah, no, you're right. You know, it would take a special situation to be able to go back, but like. And I went back and watched Africa, of course. And when I watched it, literally, it's like we are playing underwater. It's like slow motion, you know? We valued honor and integrity and lying. And then, like, now you get, it's like someone freaking injected this game with, like, toxic warp speed rocket fuel. And it's like, it's almost like a testament of what's going on in the world today. It's like, information is passed left and right. It's like crazy. And like, to go from Africa to this was like incredibly difficult.
Yeah. And you played in such a like brutal season also in Africa that no matter what happens in Fiji, it's a vacation.
Yes. Africa, it was very difficult. Even All-Star was extremely difficult. Listen, I'm really good at suffering. Let's put it that way. Yeah. I'm Jewish. I went through cancer. I can out-suffer anyone out there. So, yeah, what's your secret? I'm a sufferer. Yeah. You bring it on, I will suffer.
Okay. All right, well, we can't wait to see how this is going to play out. We're so excited, Ethan. And what do you have, of course, going on outside of Survivor?
You know, I got a little bit of this, a little bit of that. I'm deep into the CBD world, Rob.
Yes.
I got to bring.
We want to hear more about that. And what's going on with Grassroots?
So Grassroots Soccer is wonderful. You see, I'm wearing my T-shirt out there, which is exciting. You know, old school T-shirt. Yeah. Since Survivor All Star, we had about 1,000 kids graduate. Now we're in 50 countries, 2.3 million graduates. Pretty awesome.
Amazing, Ethan. Can't wait to see how it's going to go.
Thank you.
We are here with the great Sophie G. Clark. Sophie, how are you?
I'm great. I'm amongst like legends, which I'm hoping makes me a legend. But I'm great. I'm excited for the episode.
Yes, you're here. You're in the winter season. That makes you a legend.
Yeah, well, it makes me a winner, but yeah.
Sophie, by the way, congratulations that you were married last year. And you know, I love your husband, Bobby. Did playing in Survivor throw off any wedding plans for you? I know sometimes people have a wedding plan and they push it back to go be on Survivor. Did that throw off your schedule?
You know, Survivor didn't throw off my wedding schedule. But before I left, my fiance, Bobby, was very nervous that I might come back, I think, and want to throw off the schedule. I think he just heard that Survivor was an intense experience. You go through a lot of emotions. And so he definitely had some questions before I left when he was like, Sophie, we're going to get married in August, right? Like, no matter what happens. But no, we got married in August.
Sophie, what did you do to prep to go and play in season 40?
I did kind of physical prep and then, like, I don't know, like CIA spy shit. For physical prep, I did, I don't know, normal stuff, like weight, whatever, lifting weights, going for a run. But mostly what I did is I rewatched a ton of old seasons. Like Bobby hadn't seen a lot of Survivor before. So we watched, you know, Danny Boatwright's season and we watched Survivor Australia. And I literally had a dossier on every single player, their strengths, their weaknesses, a little photograph, and a little thing about like, you know, how might I play with them? What might be my in? It was fun. It was like, I felt like I was having fun with it, even if, you know, the season turned out to be a disaster.
Yeah. I get it because that once upon a time I was building a dossier also.
Nice. I wish I'd seen your dossier. It could have been helpful or maybe not helpful.
It wouldn't have been that helpful for this season. It was a really long time ago. So in this season, Cochran, another winner, was not there. Did you try to twist his arm to come play in the winter season?
Cochran gave a pretty firm no. Yeah. He didn't want to go. I also, you know, I was really bummed to not have like my one real, true, big Survivor winner fan out there as a friend. But also, like, I think I really walked into it with an advantage that I was not really connected to a lot of people. I think sometimes those connections and those friendships can be, you know, debilitating. So I liked that I was a free agent.
I read in a bunch of the interviews that you did that it really means a lot to you to go back and play Survivor. And that's not something that I always got from you. In terms of, I know you were a fan, but I didn't know how much you loved the experience of going to play Survivor. Can you talk a little bit about what that means to you to go play Survivor?
Yeah, I mean, I'm a big super fan of Survivor. So the idea of like taking myself off the couch again and putting myself back into the TV is in and of itself really exciting. But I think for me, a big part of it was I played when I was 21 and I won. Like, don't get me wrong, that's awesome. But I didn't have a ton of fun. Like, my season was really dark. I was sad a lot of the days. I was hungry. I was tired. I didn't have the best attitude. So for me, I really wanted to go back and feel like I had conquered Survivor, whether that meant winning or losing, but feeling like I could own the game in the way that I kind of hoped. I think you must relate to this. Like, when you backseat drive Survivor for long enough, you start to have that question, like, can I do it? And I was just ready to prove it to myself.
What does it mean to you to see so many of the fans excited to see you back on a season of Survivor?
I mean, it's very flattering, and it's so, I mean, I'm excited as they are for season 40. I feel like when I got the call about season 40, I first reacted with like, holy shit, we're doing a winter season. And I was like, oh my God, I'm going to be on it. So I'm stoked. I feel like, you know, all the winners are so different. It's fun that you can, you know, you can root for the nerd, or you can root for the flirt, or you can root for the super, you know, whatever, the muscle man. I have my own little niche.
And then, Sophie, outside of Survivor, what are you up to these days?
I'm still working as a kind of management consultant in healthcare. I just moved out to LA. My husband's starting a business out here, so we're in Santa Monica, enjoying the sunshine. You know, probably going to become an Instagram influencer. Oh, the usual path. Yeah. FabFitFun, you know.
All right. Well, Sophie, we're so excited to see you on this season. And, of course, great to see you in person.
Nice to see you, too. And I'm sad I'm missing your party.
Well, you'll be with us in spirit. Yeah, okay. Okay. All right. We are here with the legendary host of Survivor, Jeff Probst. Jeff, how are you?
Do you like me at all?
See, I'm so surprised that you think that, because I feel like that you get annoyed with me. Of course, I love you, Jeff, and you're such an institution. You feel like I don't like you?
You know what it is that I think there's this weird power imbalance sometimes when players are on the show, in that they don't have as much power because they don't know what the twist is, and then when the show's over they get the power back and they want to say, oh, and by the way, Probst, he's not all that. So yes, sometimes
I feel like I ever said that.
You, I'm giving you a hard time. I'm super impressed with what you've created. You're one of the few people that has turned this into an industry that you provide. You literally provide for your family from this. It's very tough to do.
Thank you very much. And I always appreciate any compliment from you. It means the world to me. And I'm so excited. It seems like you are very pumped up for this season. We've been watching all of your interviews and you seem really excited. And I feel like that there was a point when it seemed like that you didn't like it as much when players came back, like back in a million years ago when we had like the first All-Stars. It seemed like that you were like, let's get back to new players. I don't like this as much. But it seems like you really enjoy having these alumni back now.
Yeah, and you know, you bring up a really interesting point that I haven't thought of, which is I'm maturing along the way. So things that I might have said back in 2004, I might not feel today, you know? And I probably didn't understand the show as well, and I didn't understand television and why an All-Star season did make sense. But to your point, that's loud. They're coming. Even the Hollywood police want to be here. To your point, I'm super pumped about this season, and I'll tell you why. They delivered. You know. I mean, you played. You know what I mean when I say they delivered. You delivered. You stepped up. You found that you had this personality that contributed something. And I felt like you became more of it. The more you played, the more you became that person. That's how I feel about Tony and Ethan and Rob and Sandra. They know that they're known for doing certain things, and they're going to do it. I'm telling you, this will be the best season we've ever done. Even better than Heroes and Villains, Fans versus Favorites. It's off the charts good because of the players.
I feel like on social media, you are like a lightning rod where a lot of people send hate your way about things that they don't like. And I just want to say that I'm sure that's very frustrating for you to be online and then be like the recipient of a lot of negativity.
Well, I do understand that, of course, you would throw it to me. I'm the voice of the show. I'm the producer of the show. I get that. And sometimes it hurts my feelings because it's personal. And I never feel personal toward any. I love the people who play Survivor, but I'm getting better with it. But to the bigger question, which is twists and controversies and Edge of Extinction and all this stuff. Yeah, it's driven by a lot of what I'm interested in. And the point of Edge of Extinction for me was, how far would a person push themselves? What are we capable of as people? And I would say that if you look at the first person voted out, Reem.
We love Reem.
We love Reem because of Edge. Because we watched a mom be told by a group of people, we don't need a mom, go away. She gets on a boat in the middle of the night, in the middle of a dark ocean, with a torch that's about to go out as the rain is coming down. And when she lands on the beach, she says, I don't know if I can do this. Yeah. And 35 days later, she said, I did it. I find that incredibly moving. And it's back this year simply because every player said, tell me there's a Second Chance Island, because I'm damn sure not leaving my kids to be first out.
I get it. The players like it. Can I do just some quick, like, I feel like we need some PR on the Edge of Extinction. Okay. What if it stopped a little bit further away from the end, so it's not quite as easy to come back and then go on to win? Because I think that's where people get upset, where when somebody is on the edge for so long and they come back and they win and they weren't in the main game.
Right. I totally get that. And the philosophy has always been that whatever massive twist we're doing, thematic twist, it needs to pay off in the final episode. So that's how we structure it. If you looked at it as a movie, it's the last act. It has, does he get the girl? It has to pay off. But I hear what you're saying, and it is something truly to consider, which is maybe we're deep enough in the show that it doesn't have to pay off with symmetry at the very end. Maybe it can go to episode 10, and it's just a fun twist.
Because you do such a great job casting the show and finding the players that are ready to play so hard that they're ready to go, and they're ready to bring it from day one.
Yeah, and I hate losing good people. That's the reason the jury got bigger, is that we'd see somebody that was being voted out going, oh my God, we don't even get them on the jury? What if we made the jury a little bigger? These are not scientific answers. They're just ideas.
Jeff, well, hope you're doing well. We were very worried when we heard on Kelly and I was
the weirdest thing. Yeah. I truly lost my memory for 3 hours. I'm not exaggerating this one bit. It was the most bizarre thing.
It was a very scary story to hear.
It wasn't as scary to go through it because I didn't know. It was my wife retelling me. She said you had no idea who you were or why we were going anywhere. You don't remember going to the doctor, but you remembered his number by heart. It was just this weird combination of things.
All right, I know you got to get in, but Jeff, I love you, and I hope that I don't get on your nerves.
You're not on my nerves. I started by asking if you liked me. You're not on my nerves.
Okay. Well, at the last finale, I was sitting in the audience, and you came out, and you said, like, oh, I'm in my monitor, and I see Sesternino's face right in there. I'm like, oh, my God, Jeff is, I'm on... Okay.
Let's just take 30 seconds, okay? And I'm just going to tell you my truth about Survivor. And then you can mock this. Anyone can mock this all they want. Here's my truth. I love this show. I love finding people that want to play. I love spending most of my year trying to figure out what's something we could do that would twist the game so that when they get there, they go, oh, shit, now what am I going to do? And I love watching it happen. I think it's fantastic watching all these twists. And when people get so invested that they don't like it, that tells me, okay, we're in this together. You don't like it. I get it. I liked it, but I hear you. We're not going to do Edge for a while. I've heard people. I got it. I'm not saying we won't do it again. We might get a wild hair and we want to do it again. I like the back and forth, but I just wish people understood. I'm truly coming from love. This whole show changed my life. I would be nowhere without all you guys, and I just wish it was a little more harmonious rather than some of the stuff that people say on social media is just so hateful.
I know it's tough, but Jeff, thank you, and it's so great to see you.
Not a tear through that. I was trying to get just like maybe a little tear.
I'll work on it. Congratulations on 40 seasons.
Thanks,
Jeff,
man. I'll see you in there.
See you in there. Okay.